A very good morning to one and all present here. I would like to welcome you all to our webinar, Translational Pharmacy Indian Practice Perspective. Now I would request Mrs. Satya R., Assistant Professor, Department of Pharmacology, to give the introductory note.
Good morning, everyone. I, Satya R., Assistant Professor, Department of Pharmacology, Faculty of Pharmacy, Ramaiah University of Applied Sciences, take the privilege and honor to introduce our eminent speaker today. Dr. Sanish Antony completed his M.Pharm in Pharmacology from the Tamil Nadu Dr. MGR Medical University, Chennai, and PhD from JSS University, Mysore. He has supervised more than 30 postgraduate students in pharmacology discipline. He is also an external supervisor for PhD scholars at many Indian universities. Dr. Antony holds 16 years of teaching experience with 2 books authored and 35 scientific publications in reputed journals to his credits. As an academic researcher, he is expertised in stereotaxic surgical techniques, neuropharmacological screening methods, regenerative pharmacology, preventive pharmacology, molecular pharmacology, and clinical pharmacy. His core research interest is in identifying the etiologies of Parkinson's and Alzheimer's disease in relation to citrulline alteration. He is a life member in Indian Pharmacological Society and Indian Pharmaceutical Association. Dr. Sanish Antony is presently working as an assistant professor in Department of Pharmaceutical Sciences, Government Medical College, Kottayam, Kerala. With this brief introduction, I now request Dr. Sanish to take over the session. Thank you all.
Thank you. Thank you, Satya, for the nice and brief introduction.
Yes, sir.
Actually, I does not deserve this much of introduction, but still, I think there are some about 70 participants are available here. Am I audible enough?
Yes, sir. You're audible enough, sir.
Yeah, yeah. Yeah. Suppose in between, if there is a connectivity problem, kindly let me know.
Sure, sir.
Okay. And this is a virtual meeting and our virtual webinar. So there is a lacuna of having an eye contact with you people all. So I don't know how many of you are listening to me, especially the audience, student audience. And it's always we seek attention from students whenever we have any webinars. And ultimately, you community are going to be much benefited out of any of the webinars. Anyway, so I anticipate, so all the students, whoever is in this meeting, will be listening to my explanations. Some of the sharing of the information from my side for maybe 1 hour. So it is a tough job to finish or convey a theoretical to practical approaches of a subject within a stipulated period. But still, this is a practice of a webinar which we have to follow. And let me explain from the translational pharmacy. So what do you mean by this translational pharmacy? We must have heard about translational research. What is that? From the bench side to bedside. So the application of theoretical and the practical knowledge of a particular profession or a particular stream towards the human benefit is called as translational. So in the translational pharmacy, we have to focus to convert the pharmaceutical science knowledge towards the patient care for the benefit of patient community. As I explained in the summary slide or the brochure itself, so in India, we have a high level of social stigma. So most of the diseased community or so-called patient community will highly rely on, depend on physicians for diagnosis to discharge in the clinics or in the hospitals or in a healthcare setting. So where most of the drug related informations are often partially provided by the so-called physician community, but not completely. So why not completely? There is a busy schedule for the, especially Indian or most of the developing country physician. Why we say developing country physician? Because the diagnostic approaches and the concurrent developments in the medicine field or in the medicine is not reached to a stabilized condition where time could be saved. So there is a lacuna in the infrastructure, socio-economic status, and the concurrent development of other streams of medicines and science, especially technology. We call inter-sectoral developments. So when we talk about or when we think about a professional development, of course, we have to gain better knowledge and keep on updating ourselves. But not only our profession, but also we have to act as a bridge or a supportive person or personnel for inter-sectoral development. There is utmost need of a social living system, so which is highly lacking in India, I could say. So when I say this, you do not think that I am an expert in economics and socio-economical observations. But with the valid references and information what we see and what we read from so many journals and so many newspapers and so many textbooks, the information is inter-sectoral development in the field of allopathic medicine is so poor when compared with a developed country. So this is one of the most challenge what we faces when a patient entering into a clinic or a hospital to discharge. There are possibility of lot of errors during the treatment schedule as well as medication therapy management. So medication therapy management is at most important part of any treatment schedules. So why it is so? Because the patients are getting benefited or acute from a disease because of the so-called medicines which is given to the patient. So the medication management, therapy management is at most one, important one. So here, I may be utilizing another 15 minutes to explain about some of the aspects what it is presently happening in India, especially on the pharmaceutical science and pharmacy practice. Let us see. So since some of the B.Pharm and the graduate and the postgraduate students will be available, so I would like to explain some of the slides. So where you could see some basic informations. So what is pharmacy? So when people think about the pharmacy, mostly we say it is a premises where we can get some drugs or medicines. But in a broader approach, especially in the Western culture or the developed culture, so hereafter I do not mention Western culture, developed culture. So where the pharmacy is well defined with the heading or title of clinical health science, so which incorporate medicinal chemistry and medical science together to discover or produce or to dispose and a safe and effective administration of drugs and chemicals and the control of medications. So the control of medication in sense, so where from the lead discovery to inventory systems. all this. Anyway, I am not going to explain. You know basically what is the lead to an inventory schedule or inventory system of a pharmaceutical industry or pharmaceutical flow. So here, I would like to say, who is a pharmacist? So a healthcare professional is permitted and licensed to engage in pharmacy with duties including dispensing prescription. So this is one of the basic and utmost happening job in India, isn't it? Dispensing of prescription. People in India will recognize a pharmacist as a dispenser. Is it right? Is it correct? See, we are not living in 1850s or 1900s. We are living in 2021. So in the 21st century, the so-called health science or pharmaceutical science development happened to peak in most of the developed nations, but not in India. It is another major challenge when we enter or when we talk or when we think about our profession. So all of us are responsible, isn't it? Including me, you, and our teachers and your teachers. Everyone are responsible. I'm not black marking everyone. Still, I say we have to involve and evolve. That is very important. So next comes monitoring of drug interaction. So pharmacists will monitor the drug interactions. So this is a very small explanation or sentence. Easily we can say monitor drug interaction. We know drug interaction is the biggest challenge or problem in our country. Wherever drugs are administering, definitely there are going to be some adverse drug reaction, side effects, and drug interaction. Additionally, there is a drug and food interaction, drug and disease interaction, drug and geographical interaction, environment interaction, drug and ambient interaction, drug and climate interaction. These are the interactions when we administer a chemical into a human body, isn't it? So the fate of an individual who is administered with a drug is going to be decided by so-called drugs and its effectiveness, or else it is going to be wasted by drug interactions. So there is a high responsibility of a pharmacist or clinical pharmacist or community pharmacist to look into all these factors and see this administration of vaccines. Administration of vaccines, it is not actually practicing in India, but most of the developed country, the community pharmacists are responsible and licensed for administering vaccines. And next comes to counseling patients. See, again, a very simple explanation like counseling patients. We say counseling. When we study or when you study B-Pharm, D-Pharm or M-Pharm, irrespective of all subjects. See, my dear students and friends, first of all, we have to realize the profession of pharmacy, the premier profession of pharmacy, the premier objective of the profession of pharmacy is a practice-oriented. So when I talk about practice and the clinical pharmacy, community pharmacy, people think that, oh, this is SARIS or the person is always talking about M-Pharm pharmacy practice. It is not so. You just understand the basic aim or objective of a pharmacist to practice in a community. So, you know, when a person study MBBS, he may go to MD anatomy, MD pathology, MD surgery. See, the MD anatomy personnel who is going to A to Z of anatomy within a campus medical practice because he has completed any audible.
Yes, sir. Audible. We're able to hear.
Yeah, because actually showing some comments like the internet connection is poor, but there is a good connectivity. Anyway, Satya, if I am not audible, you can make a WhatsApp call to me.
Yes, sir.
I made my mobile phone forward, so you can make a WhatsApp call. Okay. Sorry for the interruption. Yeah. So so I just stopped with the counseling aspect, right? So the counseling comes as part of a practice. So anybody who have completed either D-Pharm or B-Pharm and registered as a pharmacist in a respective council of a state is allowed and permitted to practice, having the license and holding the license to practice pharmacy in a community pharmacy or in a clinical pharmacy. So when I talk about a clinical pharmacy in a hospital, there is an amendment. Anyway, that amendment slides we will go later. Anyway, most of you must have heard about or saw about what are the amendments happened in 7A and 7B part of pharmacy practice regulations 2015, and now it is an amendment made on 30th June 2021. So there is an additional addendum called 7A and 7B. Then comes to regarding the proper usage of drugs and dietary supplement. That is also very, very important, because the successful of a medication therapy management and its fruitfulness is highly dependent upon the proper use of drugs along with lifestyle and the dietary supplements. See, the physicians most probably dependent upon the representatives. Anyway, I will come to these points in the later slides. But when a patient is given with a drug, and all the drugs are chemicals, most probably some chemicals are nasty chemicals, some chemicals are moderately nasty, some chemicals are okay. We say the okay chemicals are like OTC, over-the-counter drugs. But still, over-the-counter drugs also can endanger the life of an individual chronically, as well as when there is a combination, bad combination of other drugs and along with the other, the bad combination of some foods and the OTC preparations also can endanger the life of an individual or harm some organs of the individual. So these are the responsibility and the role of a pharmacist towards the community. So now, when say it is a role and responsibility, so responsibility should come first, because role is like it is like something licensed, and responsibility comes like something it is service. So always the public or layman will going to accept you as a service individual, because it is not for the layman your profession or the pharmacy profession needs to be broadened. It is for the layman the pharmacy profession should broaden to offer the better care towards the nation or towards himself. So that is the approach. So when you talk about I'm going to expand my profession or our profession of pharmacy, nobody is going to accept you in the society. Instead, if you are saying you are going to take care of the health of the community and safeguard the community through pharmaceutical care, then people will have some sort of acceptance, because yes, this fellow is coming to or ready to save our life and give better care, give us better health. So that is on that should be the approach of each and every practicing pharmacist, not to broaden our profession. It is to safeguard the health of the individual or all individuals of the country. So now, and for the student community, I would like to say, who is a physician? Because always we think like a doctor and a physician will be misunderstandable. A physician is a person who is practicing medicine. A doctor is a person who is having a doctoring principles and knowledge of a particular subject. So physician is expert of medicine, and a doctor is holding the doctoring principles of a particular subject. So see, why I would like to focus this? When we have, or when you have completed your PharmD or PhD after M-Pharm, some people I have found, let us say like a doctor, but what is our role? What is our value in the society? It is not so. So even a history doctor, because the person who is holding doctrine, principles, and knowledge of history is having a very good role. You know, when I say this, as in every part of every talk, just we are focusing some information about even history to pharmacy. There is a connectivity in all subjects. That's what I was talking about, the intersectoral development. I will tell you an example for this history. Amazing, little and interesting point. You know why history is useful in medicine? Do you know, in our pharmacy? Do you know? Understanding the earlier consequences or past consequences of a phenomena of some diseases or morbidity of a community of an individual, if it is properly recorded, so those informations will be much useful for the invention of new lead or alteration of lead, or to modify our living system or living condition or our food habits. So there is a lot of connectivity between the district. See, for example, in Coimbatore, districts now, the population of Coimbatore districts comes around 60 lakhs. In 1920, the population of Coimbatore district was only 2.8 lakh. Will you believe? So those days, the number of diabetic patients in Coimbatore, it is documented by a British physician, and it is there in the library of Coimbatore Public Library. Those days, the diabetes mellitus was not curable. Most of the people, those who got diabetes mellitus, will have high level of morbidity and they will become thin and die after some years. What about now? So there were only about 20 diabetes mellitus people were lived in 1920. Could you believe? Now in a street, hundreds of diabetic people. So now we have to address. So how history is going to be useful now? What was the food and cultural habits of those population at 1920 and 2020. So this will give you a drastic information, beautiful information, how we can either prevent or alter or postpone diabetes mellitus nowadays as mimicking those days' lifestyle and food style, isn't it? So when you complete your M.Pharm, Ph.D. or Ph.D., well, you can proud of yourself that, yes, I am a pharmacy doctor, isn't it? So everyone who have completed such graduation, pharmacy doctors. So who is a compounder? So because when you go to a society now and they talk all this matter to your grandparents or nearby people, they say, yeah, you study pharmacy, it is just a compounder job. No? So even in Tamil or in Malayalam, people used to say compounder, it's compounder. So before 1960s, there was a personal job like called a compounder, who compounds a lot of chemicals. The raw material for preparation of some drugs will be available in the dispensaries or in the hospitals. So who is having some basic idea about the chemical reactions and who knows to handle the reactors? Master and bezel, like some of the instruments. So those fellows were called as addressed as compounder. But now this is obsolete. So now let us physician concentrate on the diagnosis, and let us the pharmacy doctor or so-called pharmacist concentrate on medication therapy management. So this should be our objective hereafter. And then when come to the worldwide repository data of pharmacists, so there are some data which we have to understand. See, in India, as per the 2018 statistics of World Health Organization, we have 8.87 pharmacists per 10,000 population. You know, actually, one pharmacist per 1,000 population is the ideal population, pharmacist to population ratio. So as per that, we need 10. That means 10 pharmacists for each 10,000 population. But in India, it is 8.87. You know, this is the population of India pharmacists, including me, an academic pharmacist, an industrial pharmacist, a research pharmacist, our R&D pharmacist, and the pharmacovigilance side, and the community pharmacy, those who are working as a clinical pharmacist, all together put all this, some number, 8.87. And anyway, the details of this data I will tell you in the forthcoming slides. So in the United Kingdom also it is more or less same, 8.89. Now there is a big question like, yes, India as well as UK, we are equal with respect to the number of pharmacist population. But why the pharmaceutical care is not evolved or developed in India? Yes, this is a question. This is a question myself, for myself as well as to yourself. Yes, let us try to find out some of the solutions, some of the reasons and solutions for this question. Am I audible?
Yes, sir, you're audible, sir.
Yeah. So, because during this presentation, I am not able to see any of the screen, only I am looking at my, the setting is so, that's all.
Yes, sir, if there is any problem, we will let you know, sir.
Yeah, fine. So, in Australia, you see, it is 8.81. There are some countries where the pharmacist population is very, you know, in Japan, it is very high, I think it is around 16. See, in Ireland, it is 11.62. Yeah, it is 18. It is Japan, as per 2016 data, it is 18 points. You know, is more than double the number of pharmacists in India or in even UK. And in Netherlands, it is only 2.1. You know, surprisingly, then how they are managing? Because the reason for this is in Netherlands, there are very, very less industries are available. So all the pharmacists of the Netherlands, mostly they are oriented with community pharmacy as well as hospital or clinical pharmacy services. Pakistan, it is only 1.58. So when you look at Uganda and you look at Tanzania, you know, the number comes in decimals. So this is what the situation global wide. So now, dear students, you have to understand what is a pharma market job in India. So we have around 1 million pharmacists. So these are some of the data which I have collected from repository, government repositories, family health and family welfare department. There are 2,000 to 3,000 medium to large scale industries. So you know, average around 8 lakh pharmacies. You know, in India we have around 10 lakh clinics. And 8 lakhs of pharmacies, 70,000 of hospitals. See, this 70,000 come excluding dispensaries. So now very, very less number of dispensaries are available, including the PHSE. It includes the PHSEs. There are 3,213 industries, institutes, around 4,000 faculty. So this is the 50,000 faculty. So this is the resource, pharma job resource in India. Then, in spite of all these resources, there are a lot of pitfalls. So one of the major pitfalls is like the sale of pharma products or the medicines or drugs in India is not scientifically or lawfully regulated. That is another major challenge. So why, you know, we are studying Drugs and Cosmetics Act 1940 and Rules 1945, from so many years. But as a law body, it is not implemented completely in the society. So that is one of the major issue. On top of that, now we have another problem of e-pharmacy sale. So e-pharmacy sale in India is one of the another challenge which we are going to face. So the so-called dispensing pharmacy or community pharmacy, the fame and the need is going to be obsolete or partially obsolete. So this is another challenge. So how we are going to tackle this? How we are going to challenge this? Does we have any challenges or any overcoming tools or ideas or chances to overcome this? So this is another question which we have to raise. Yes, we have. If we implement the practice of pharmacy through community pharmacy services in India, definitely we need not to look at the sale, or the sale even could contribute only 20-25%. With the 20-25% of normal sales volume of a community pharmacy, a pharmacist can earn well if he practices community pharmacy services in India. So when it comes to the job satisfaction index in India, only 50% of the population, pharmacy population, are satisfied, remaining are dissatisfied. And if you look at the, when I talk about the pharmacy, then you feel that only pharmacists are dissatisfied. No, the physician community or the medicine community also dissatisfied. You know, in Kerala, this is the statistics of Kerala. I do not have the statistics of Karnataka. I'm sorry. Just to understand some relationships. As per WHO, again, one physician or doctor needs for 1,000 population. In Kerala, it is 1.5. So then what is the net effect? In Kerala, Sikh hospitals, doctors are the first casualty. That is the problem. See, high pressure from the hospital administration to induce polypharmacy. So a prescription which contains a lot of unnecessary drugs are called as polypharmacy, you know, you are aware of it. So now the polypharmacy, unnecessary laboratory test, diagnostic test, the high hospital bill, and then lack of individual care towards the patient, especially in the case of medication therapy management. See, all this process will be busy and costly process. Even the medicine purchase will be costly. You know, somebody admitted in a hospital and they say, yeah, I got medical reimbursement, all treatment. But the pharmacy bill comes around 40,000 or 30,000 every day for 4,000 rupees or 5,000 rupees for drugs, injections and drugs. You know, ultimately, the fellow or the diseased individual is going to be cured or getting off from the disease because of the so-called drugs and medicines. So when these many number of drugs and medicines and crucial medicines are administering, is there a crucial lookup or care towards the patient in this medication therapy management? This is the question. Is it happening? Now, you look at, if we address this question, so patient satisfaction index in India is only 40%. This is also an evidence of the data as per 2018 article, scientific article. So why it is happening in India? As well as Central Bureau of Health Intelligence. If you look at this website, you will get a lot of information about the health statistics as well as the treatment pitfalls and even PVP drawbacks, implementation drawbacks, I say. So as per these resources, I'd like to say average of 15 to one request. Actually, could you remove me from co-host, because some comments are appearing repeatedly on the screen, so which makes me difficult to see the screens.
Yes, sir.
Yeah. So average of 15 to 20 crores of Indians visits hospitals every year. So, and so we are seeing only 6.7% of serious adverse drug reactions. So it means the adverse drug reactions are very less in India, isn't it? It is not so. So studies have cited side effects as the reason for 3.4% of hospital admissions in India. So this is as per only the documented data, again is say. Then 3.7% of hospital admissions and 1.8% of mortality. See, now just let us calculate average of 15 to 20 crores of Indians visit hospital every year. From this 20 crores population, if you calculate this 1.8% of mortality, so the mortality per day comes 8,500 Indian death due to adverse drug reactions. It is not a bogus information. It is as per the Health Intelligence Bureau of India. So you may not believe. How, sir? 8,500 Indian deaths, even Corona or COVID, so-called COVID-19, caused a maximum of 4,000 or 5,000 deaths. You know, in India, even before COVID, the average death number per day is around 25 to 30,000 per day. Because such a populated country, around 140 or 135 crores of Indians. So out of this bigger number, so 25,000 to 30,000 deaths are happening every day. You know, out of which 8,500 deaths are due to ADR, which is unacceptable. So why? Because either me or you or my relative or your relative, dear and near, anybody can be part of this victim. Isn't it? Because admitted in the hospital for any of the ailments, during the medication therapy management, there is a chance of occurrence of ADR. If it becomes serious and leads to mortality, that is a very huge number. This we have to focus to the community. To whom? Not to pharmacy community. We have to, pharmacist community should aware these facts and say to the publics. It may be through an NGO, it may be through a political organization, it may be through some society, wherever the possibilities are available. See, we have to make aware of these informations. So there is no guarantee that if you are admitted in a hospital, sometimes the drug is going to kill you. Oh, isn't it? What should we do then? There is a need of clinical pharmacist in a hospital. It is not assured that during even an outpatient treatment, some of the drugs may cause severe organ damage. Upon that, you may get a severe ailments later on, maybe after 5 years or some years, leads to mortality or organ replacement, transplant surgeries. So these are the problems. So when publics are aware about these information and the facts, these dark facts, so definitely public will have an induction to ask a question. Where is the service of clinical or community pharmacy in India? This public should ask to the political organization and governmental body. Then there will be a pressure to implement the system in India, isn't it? Or if you say, I'm going to expand and broaden the profession of pharmacy, nobody is going to listen to you. Maybe sometime at the Ramayya University or the SS University or some government institution, we can have webinars like this and people will listen, 100 people or 200 people will listen and they will forget and go. There will not be some usefulness of this session. Until or otherwise, these type of information need to be propagated. Those propagated information will indulge the public to ask a question and they have to ask to the governmental body or governmental system. So this is for just example which I have quoted the death daily. And the pharmacovigilance program in India, if you look at the objective and the principle and implementation strategy of the pharmacovigilance program of India, is very good. But how far it is implemented? How far it is implemented is a question. You know, very, very poor penetration of PV, pharmacovigilance in India healthcare system. Lot of journal, even Journal of Pharmacovigilance in 2018, they have a lot of information. Even you can go through this article. You can have a screenshot of this and read this article. You'll get a lot of information. So what is the reason? So in spite of a chronological development of PV from 1747 to 1962. Why 1962? The Uppsala Drug Monitoring Committee and International Drug Monitoring Committee and all implemented on 1962. You know where we are standing now, 2021. Most of the developed country well implemented this pharmacovigilance program. It is a strict follow-up. There is a strict follow-up every day, every hour. But in India, there is nothing. Such a situation is not there. Because pharmacovigilance is an error identifying system. What error? Which error? Medication error identifying system. If there is a medication error, who is responsible now? Physicians are responsible. They are writing the prescription. So if this system is implemented in India, 8,500 deaths are going to be reduced and people's lives are going to be saved. But in spite of that, the physician community will be under pressure or might be under pressure. Think 10 times before write a prescription. Is it happening in India now? Is it happening around of us? This is a question. This question you have to arise to the public. So now, then how India tackles adverse drug reactions? Very simple answer, by ignoring data. You know, 10% of all medicines produced worldwide or popular worldwide are taken in India. You know, yet it accounts for only 2% of globally occurring side effects of medicine. You know, Australia and US is the country in the world, they reports more than 13% of adverse drug reactions. In India, you see, 10 times of population, in spite of that, globally we report only 2% of ADR. So what a pity information it is, isn't it? So those masked ADRs are going to kill us, going to kill the community, going to morbid the community, going to injure the community of animal as well as man. So this is another big or serious issue we have to think about and propagate to the public. So there is a source, you can just go through this. You know, the reason doctors in India are much careless in prescribing medicines because they know they will not be held accountable for their actions. That is another interesting fact. And a weekly year also. You know, in an incident happens, which I am not explaining much. Even on physician's wife, the physician couple who settled at US, they came to India and they got some disease and admitted in a hospital. The busy physician's wife died of serious adverse drug reaction. And he filed a suit in 1998. He succeeded, I think, with some of, even he went up to Supreme Court. You know, a normal layman like me or you cannot go to Supreme Court. A Supreme Court, one lawyer sitting is, you know, per day, it is invariably from 2 lakh to 8 lakh. Even for single hearing, can we pay 2 lakh, 3 lakh rupees for challenging some system? So this is one of the major drawback of our country. Only the rich will get justice. Anyway, I am not coming to that part. So mostly the physicians are depend upon, instead of medical journals and drug journal, they are depending upon representative, so-called representative. Even I am sorry if some physicians are there and listening this presentation. You have to realize and address. I'm not saying 100% of the physician community is doing this job, but I could say most. Then why? What is the need of a representative queue in front of a physician? Don't the physician is having IDR, Indian Drug Review? Don't the physician is having in India, if he is having MIMS, Monthly Index of Medical Specialty? Don't the physician is having SIMS, Current Index of Medical Specialty? There are a lot of online journals available, online drug bullets available, hospital formularies are available. Beyond all this, what a great information going to gain from a representative. So it is very simple answer. Representative will give the physician some gifts and articles and commission for writing a prescription. Again, I say, it is not like, I'm not pointing like everybody is doing, but there is a happening in India. So this is what the system. So where we could, am I audible?
Yes, sir, you're audible, sir.
Yeah, I'm sorry. Yeah. For a patient, is sometimes decided, even so-called the, so this system need to be changed for the sake of benefit of the community. And, you know, again, the ignorance. So Some doctors even do not know where to report ADR and how to report ADR. If you are not having an argument with me, just to ask them. See, a physician who is giving a treatment or practicing medicine, at any moment, ADR could be monitored or heard from a physician. Patient. If so, there should be a resource to report this ADR or PV on his fingertip. I say these mobile phones or internet laptops. But how they are reporting? Are they reporting daily? If they are identifying, if any drug food interaction also should be reported. So there is a high level of ignorance. You see, I could say some of the physicians' brokerage might cost a life. You know, illegible writing, and the words and sentences of the drug name could not be even identified by even a dispensing fellow of other pharmacy. So this is a deal between sometimes pharmacy to a physician, a code word like system. In 2016, there is a very strict rule that all the physicians of India should write the drug name in capital letters, mention the dose correctly, numerical figures. And also, MCA insisted the physicians to write the generic name of the drug. Is it happening in India? In spite of that 2016 amendment in MCA Act, you see this prescription written on 23-2019. How it is? Could you read it and understand what drugs are there? Which drugs are there? See, other prescription, which I have taken a photograph from my mobile. Could you read this? This is an allopathic prescription. This is a funny prescription. Somebody wrote a VSOP brandy and all. So this is what happening. See, again, I am not pinpointing all the physician community, but there is a system. Even you go to a physician in a normal clinic or in a private practice center, and you get the prescription. 99% of the prescription could not read. Even as a doctorate in pharmacy fellow, you people cannot read, because it is a deal between that storekeeper and the physician. This code word can be identified by or read by only that people. Then apart from that, counterfeit. So the counter, because you go to internet shopping, medicine shop, any drugs, you know, you will get A to Z drugs. 2,055 generic drugs are available in allopathic system. So in India, I am saying about. See, we have around 79,000 of brands in India. So one brand and another brand will mislead sometime. Even this prescription will be misread by an online seller. So these are the challenges which is happening, existing. So who is there to correct and who is there to verify the system? Out of these problems, out of these difficulties, who is there in the community to take care of the patient and make the patient to get clarify the doubts and queries of medication therapy management? Is that system available or existing in our community? This is my question. Answer for this. This question we have to ask to the public. Let them come with some answer. We have a counterpoint to say. Anyway, I will tell you. Now, this is another example where a victim of a hurry decision. Anyway, see, it happened in Calcutta, a 17-year-old boy. So, had a Steve Johnson syndrome because of even Dapsone. Because during the hospital, inpatient hospital visit, either a clinical pharmacist or a physician should have a deep look into the symptoms of the gross anatomical symptoms of the patient. If there is an abnormal observation, immediately it should be enquired of. Most probably it will not happen. So what happened? Third day, fourth day, after a week, these gradual responses will become, say, syndrome and sometimes becomes fatal. So this is another major problem of our system in India. So some people will die of Steve Johnson syndrome. There are a lot of problems, severe allergic reactions, severe neutropenia. You know, more than 200 drugs, common drugs, are producing neutropenia. You know, it is liable to kill a patient due to opportunistic infection. Then, so these are all we have to address. And so, who is there to? So, because physicians, I am not natively focusing physician community. No, you have our physician community having a skill of practicing medicine by diagnosing a disease, because it is a bigger art and challenge. Diagnosing a disease is a bigger art and challenge. You know, now we have MRI and PET scan and CT scan and even X-ray technology, all this we have. Even when we have such images, but assuming what might happen inside the body and identifying exactly the disease and come to the correct diagnosis and giving a proper medication is very, very challenging one. So that diagnosis and the health prognosis done by a physician, let the medication therapy management managed by or done by a practicing pharmacist. So this is our motto. And so now it is very easy to report ADR in PVP. This is a toll-free number. Anyway, all this information are available in the website, and even you can mail it to them, and or you can have a app. So this app I have in my mobile. Whenever we hear or whenever we see or whenever we go to a war round, if you are practicing, immediately we can assess that and we can report it to ADR. Then they will have a final judgment over it. You need not to worry about it. Just your report. Just you write your assumption, your proposal. Now, how a pharmacist can evolve to a public health provider? See, now we're dispensing pharmacists to a public health provider. That is one of the major slogan. So this slogan, the focus is on consulting pharmacy or consulting pharmacist. So can I or can you become a consulting pharmacist? This is a question. So we have to answer this with our professional ability. So are we capable of doing so? Are we packed up with some knowledges, basic knowledges? Again, I say, nobody can gain 100% knowledges. Whatever I have learned when I was studying M-Pharm before 16 years, so most of that must be volatilized. What I learned before some years may not be remembering always, but we have a basic idea, basic principles. That's what we studied our profession, into a profession. With that basic idea, when you sit to practice yourself, you will evolve with the day-by-day activities. So with some of the supporting resources. So what are the supporting resources? Textbooks, the authentic informations which are available from textbooks. You know, there is a society called American Society of Consultant Pharmacists. It's there, it's very active society in US. There is such a situation in India, Indian Society of Consultant Pharmacists. Why we are not capable of, we are not bold enough to implement such a system? This is a question to you. You ask to pharmacist, say an answer to the community. Now, clinical pharmacy. So anyway, I thought some UG students and all will be there. So I wanted to just share some definitions. So it can be defined as branch of pharmaceutical science, which utilizes pharmacist knowledge and skills and judgment. So this is very important, pharmacist knowledge and skill. See, skill always cannot learn from a classroom, that you have to understand. Skill always can be learned sometime from tutorials or a verbal or discussion with your teacher or your seniors or some practicing people or who is working in a PVP. Then some of the judgment. So judgment related to the theory as well as your skill and knowledge should coincide. And so these informations should be based upon biomedical and pharmaceutical sciences, not on the myth. So this is very important. Then to provide safety and the cost and the precision of the drug effectiveness in the patient. So we use our knowledge, skill, our judgment of biomedical and pharmaceutical knowledges and implements a system to provide safety and the cost effectiveness and 100% treatment satisfaction. I mean medication therapy management satisfaction. So when there is a implementation of drug or medicine, there should be a pharmacist. In India, the salary starts from 20,000 to 50,000, 55,000, even after 20 years of experience. You know, in governmental system in India, most of the states, a pharmacist, even a pharmacy teacher, are earning lakhs. The salaries are in lakhs. That is ideal, at par with industrial chamber norms. So there is a living economical index for an individual. Even after pharmacy getting 15,000, 20,000 rupees, as per the inflation rate of present in our nation, even the inflation of our GDP and all. So it is very, very difficult to move ahead with the 20 or 25,000 rupees within our Indian cities or urban area. So the pharmacy profession is lagging with its economical status nowadays. So how to improve it? So this is another question and challenge. So let us work and desired income yourself. Is it possible? Even during a webinar, I could indulge you, but it is up to you to take this as a challenge and going to implement it or not. So pharma clinic. So when I say pharma clinic, you people may think that is very, very difficult to have a virtual webinar. No, I am not at all looking at live eyes. If I am looking at live eyes, I could understand, I could read your expression accordingly, I can modulate. Now only I could see the laptop camera where some small lights is there. Anyway, kindly cope up with the explanation. I'm sorry for the same. So how we can implement a pharma clinic in India with a legal validity? That is another question. Does it is legally valid or allowed in India? You look at abroad, developed countries and all, there is a clinical consultant pharmacist blogs, and even it is a Facebook, from Facebook I have taken lot of dollars, lots of dollar she is earning out of consultants. Online consultancy, private personal consultancy, pharma clinic consultation. It is not happening in India. So the question is, can an Indian pharmacist practice in pharmacy clinic? So, you know, when January 2015, when pharmacy practice regulations made in India or published in Indian Gazette, actually some of the practicing community, medicine practicing community were afraid of reading those regulations. Because in that regulation, it is well explained that, or well defined that, a practicing pharmacist can fix this piece. Not only for dispensing of medicines or drugs, but also for identifying adverse drug reactions, drug interaction, drug-food interaction, and prescription errors, minimizing polypharmacy, and convincing the patient community and the caretakers, and all these counseling aspects as well as practice aspects were defined, and the duties and responsibilities were defined, and the salary can be, or the fee, not salary, fee can be fixed by a pharmacist. So the brilliant back players of the scene, I don't want to mention somebody. If this pharmacy practice clinics are going to happen in India, the income from the representative, or I say purely like a commission from the representative, will be in soup. So some of the community or some of the people asked even an RPA question to Pharmacy Council of India. So what are the questions? See, first let me say, a lawful act called as Pharmacy Practice Regulation 2015, PPR 2015. Pharmacy, so it is a part of Pharmacy Act 1948. So pharmacists can practice as like doctors within their own clinics setups on patient consultation. So this is allowed. So as per that regulation, it is allowed to practice like doctors. See, again, I say doctors in sense, it is actually should be physicians. But anyway, it is a we have always a layman language. If you say physician, somebody will think something else. So doctors in common. So doctors, as doctors, they can practice in own clinic. What practice they can do? See, you know, as per that regulation, everything you can practice except diagnose and prescribe, diagnose the disease and prescribe the drugs. That's all. You see the question, can pharmacist open a clinic in India? It was a lots of question arises against this practice regulation. And then upon that question, Pharmacy Council of India given a clarification. What was that clarification? Clearing the doubts on pharmacists can open pharma clinics to treat common diseases and prescribe medicine. Pharmacy Council of India has recently notified that pharmacists cannot open clinics to diagnose the disease and prescribe medicines. Oh, this is the end of the story. You know, most of our pharmacy colleagues and the fellow pharmacists thought that no, we cannot open the clinic. No, you can open the clinic. You can practice pharmacy in the clinic, but not by diagnosing the diseases and prescribing the medication. Except all the practice can be possible or is possible as per the pharmacy practice regulation. You have to read this regulation well. Then you will understand. Anyway, I am not just replicating and reading. I will show this. This is available in the internet. Easily you can get from Google search even itself, or if you go to Pharmacy Council of India website, you will get Pharmacy Practice Regulation 2015. In that, you know, page 28, Code of Ethics is well defined, and they defined clinical pharmacist. What is the role of a clinical pharmacist? But now the qualification have been changed. That see in the bigger hospital, tertiary care hospital setups or in hospital setup. What is the qualification of a clinical pharmacist is well defined now with the 7A and 7B addendum in appendix. Now become a big problem, like all M.Pharm people are getting afraid. No, we cannot work, we cannot join. Why always you are looking at a bigger hospital and go there and work as a slave of so-called physician or some administration? You can open your clinic still, even a B-Pharm pharmacist with a registered certificate, registration, or B-Pharm or M-Pharm, irrespective of any branch. You can work as a community pharmacist. You can practice pharmacy. So payment of professional fees and service. Anyway, I'm not repeating this. I'm not reading. Just you can see this is what they have explained in page number 31 and 32. So he's allowed to collect the fee for the service. Duties and responsibilities, what I have told you, overutilization, therapeutic duplication, drug disease interaction, which you can just go through. Pay number, I think, pay number 49. And patient counseling, these are the responsibilities of a community pharmacist or practicing pharmacist in India. Now, this is what the change made, Appendix 3. Just you can go through this also anyway. In this qualification, they have mentioned like a PharmD. So now, what is the scenario? A person or a registered pharmacist with the PharmD graduation can work as a clinical pharmacist in a hospital setting, tertiary care hospitals. But is this amendment is preventing you to practice in a community as a community pharmacist? Or practice in your pharmacy clinic as a clinical pharmacist? No. So this we have to well aware of. These are the amendments. Anyway, you can again say 7A and 7B, two addendum have been added to Appendix 3. So anyway, what you need for to become a practicing pharmacist? It's very simple. There are authentic and high standard book written by a developed country authors. Don't think Indian authors are bad now. There are a lot of Indian authors also. Very nicely they have explained the duties and responsibilities and the scientific part and the academic aspect of pharmacy. So these, see now, one of the major challenges for the student as well as the practicing professionals are immediately we take a mobile and we will search in Google and the information in short we assign and we will get from the Google and that we depend upon. See, as far as you have these resources, even 100, 200, thousands of information, doubts you can clarify within some hours. You know, with the major drawback, only the internet and the software is evolved and our brain, human brain could not evolve. You know, last 20 or 30 years, the drastic development is technology. Do you think that as per that, accordingly, the human brain also developed? No, we have a limit. We have a statutory limit. So if you learn and acquire a lot of information fastly within a fraction of seconds, as far as that, you will volatile. It will be volatile. It will vaporize. So reading some concepts and understanding some concepts, patiently taking some time and read the hard copy or text materials, if it is available, you purchase it, that give you a good pack of knowledge. At most, it is at most needed for an academic pharmacist, practicing pharmacist, as well as the students. Anyway, these are the process. Anyway, I'm not making a scientific part in explanation of all this. You know, a pharmacist consultation, how it should be. That is what I was saying about the medication therapy management. From reviewing the patient records and database, then review the medications. See, just I say reviewing means it is not a simple process. It is a very valid process. Reviewing, as like we call research. So research is a wonderful job, right? It is a complex job. It is a loving job. Why? Because we are researching, again and again researching. All people cannot do, or anybody can do this. Anybody cannot do this. Sorry. It is a skillful job. Like research, review the medications and the safety of the medication. And then the list out the what are the problems or some of the problematic medications and what are the unsafe medications. Give priority for the safety of the patient. Then you can intervene with this therapy process directly with the patient, advise them, implement a plan, give him ideas. This is a big artistic and a nice job. Then you can intervene with the physician who wrote the medication and convince the physician that these are the problems and these are the drawbacks if it is existing. Ask the physician to change the medicines either through the patient or directly to the physician. This system will not support in India now. As far as now, never if you are practicing and if you are called to a physician and this prescription given to so and so, aging so and so, this person and having a big problem, and then the physician will shout at you with bad words sometimes. You'll be angry. But see, in a professional system, there is no meaning or no voice for a hard voice or loud voice or angriness. So we have to deal all the situations genuinely. That is very important. Genuineness is very important. So the genuine scientific incorporation of pharmacist knowledge and physician knowledge is ultimately going to benefit the physician, sorry, patient community. So this is what we have to say to the community, that we have to practice. Then documenting the physician, sorry, the patient data, sorry for the slip of tongue, patient data, and then you implement a special medication related action plans. If the drugs are highly noxious, like I say, anti-cancer drugs, anti-rheumatoid arthritis drugs, immunosuppressive drugs. So when the patients are taking these type of drugs, what are the special requirement or special precautions need to be given to the patient as well as to the caregivers? So these all should come in a medication management therapy schedule. Now, just for some, so because when I say all theoretical aspects and the general aspects, some students may have a question like this, how to really we can do. So when you get a prescription with this blue cuboid or this square box, is a prescription contains metformin, genelecliptin, atorvastatin. So now, when these prescriptions are given to a patient, and the patient can have a monthly once or a quarterly visit to the physician, maybe six. But how the medication goes on, whether the patient is having a proper or adherence to the, we call this compliance, adherence to the medication, as well as the dietary side and the other lifestyle is maintained well, whether adequately nutrition is supplied. So this and all should be inquired during the patient or pharmacy or pharmacist, patient pharmacist consultation. And so for this suspect, you know, somebody can, if you think of, you may laugh at the concept, but I have just taken these pictures to motivate you to have a pharmacy clinic with like ambience, like this ambience. So invest some few lakhs to create an ambience and adequately knowledge yourself. And so where you can, so never a clinic or this is like dispensaries or clinic where only money is the first priority. And there is a rushy physician and a rushy pharmacist sitting in a clinic or working in a clinic where a patient comes. And even, you know, in Indian system, the patient may not or cannot ask even some genuine questions or doubts to the physician. Physician will become angry. You know, I don't have this time. This is enough. What you eat accordingly, what I have written. The pharmacist fellow will tell you how to eat the medicine. That's all. No drug-food interaction, no dose clarification, even a psychological tactic to deal with the patient. It is not existing in most of the physician community, unfortunately. That is an opportunity. There is an opportunity for the practicing pharmacists to implement all that positive part. You know, you receive the patient and you aware himself. Who is he? How is he? I say, homeostatically, I'm meaning, not all in social aspect. So how homeostatic is his body by measuring body weight, blood pressure, even take a glucose test, glycemic index, and have a podiatry evaluation. So this and all, you know, podiatrist is not a big job. Any can practice podiatry, even without a degree practice podiatry. Just looking at the nail and if there is any problem in cleaning the nail and the curving properly, unnecessary curving should be avoided. And even diabetic and the elderly people will have a lot of podiatric problems. You know, if you look at your soul, the sides of your soul, the melanized sides of your soul will have a lot of dark or black spots. What it means? It is a liver burden. Copper and iron deposition started happening in your skin because of liver burden. So what you should do? You should do exercise as well as eliminate fat from your body. Liver burden will reduce. These are the very tactic and the small information available in community medicine and the pharmacology and even pathophysiology, a lot of information are available in standard textbooks, what we read for. So those should be practically applied to the patient. And aware himself, what? The BMI. So you can just weigh the body and the height. In height you can measure by using the instrument provided there. and then you can say this is what your BMI. So you, when the BMI falls between 20, 25, 23, 24, so it is very ideal, normal. When you go to 25 and above, it is overweight, obesity. So now you can well make aware. Then body fat calculator, it is interesting one. This is our calculator.net. If you go to website, you can, if you enter all this numerical value, corresponding value, the website itself, the software itself will give you the exact results. So it is very freely, you can download it and you can have it on your laptop or your mobile phone. You see the way here, age and weight and height and the neck diameter and the waist diameter and the hip diameter. If you measure all this, you can exactly say what is the percentage of fat in a particular person. So now when I calculated this, it came around 15.6, it is fitness. When it goes to 17.5 and above, it is average. When it goes to about 25, it is obese. So now make the patient aware, and accordingly you have to regulate with your info, with the scientific information. You see, when come to the intervention, a very simple example, that's what I don't want to complicate by putting a lot of examples. See, when a person takes metformin, there are two chances, no? One, B2, the B12 level will reduce and there is a chance for lactic acidosis. So what are the approaches a clinical pharmacist or practicing pharmacist can intervene with? So monitor B12 level and prescribe vitamin B12. So who can monitor? You ask the physician, sorry, patient. Next time when you have a physician visit, you ask him, because you can have some questions like, do you have any problem when you are walking for long? Do you have any problem when you are upright or holding your hand for 10 or 20 seconds? Even some people having muscular problem like myopathy or neuropathy, like because of diabetes mellitus or because of B12, even they cannot even make the clothes to dry for longer time, even on the threads and all or the rope. You people used to wash and rinse the cloth, and we people used to make it for dry, spread it for dry on the rope. But some people, no, after spreading the 3-4 clothes to make or spread over the rope, they will have a shoulder pain or leg pain or muscle fatigue. That is either a symptom of a peripheral neuropathy or a myopathy. So what are the causes? It could be a fatty liver disorder and the vitamin absorption, low vitamin absorption, vitamin D absorption is less, or presence of myopathy like disorder. So this and all can be asked to the patient, and this type of intervention or questions can be asked to the patient to identify the problems. And if you identify the problems and report to the physician through your official or prescription letter. So a pharmacist can have a consultation letter note. So in the consultation letter or consultation note, you can note all this to the physician or to the patient. Then ask the patient to report physician if urine smells strong and dark, and the patient is having deep breath, nausea, frequent headache, nasal congestion. What are these problems? These are the problems of lactic acidosis. You may think that metformin will not cause lactic acidosis, or only fenformin will cause. Now, metformin also could cause lactic acidosis in some population. Then atorvastatin. Anyway, I'm sorry, I'm consuming much time. And so which type of cholesterol? So we have to first identify which type of cholesterol it is by seeing the cholesterol lipid profile. It is available, all this information you can just go through. And if we require for the reduction of more than 45% of cholesterol, then only we have to go for atorvastatin. Otherwise, fibrates are sufficient, or dietary modification are sufficient. And even before prescription of or prescribing atorvastatin, there should be definitely the transaminase level should be monitored. If it is not monitored, it was not monitored, there is a big mistake in the medication therapy management. So you have to advise the patient, inform the physician, and get it tested, then only should be continued. Then concurrent administration of inhibitors also should be a very or it is also a concern. Now another aspect of metformin counseling is like so metformin should be taken with food. Avoid leafy vegetables more than 30 grams. So why this 30 grams? Because 30 grams are the minimum requirement of vegetables per day for an individual. So more than that, if a person takes along with the metformin, there will be a bloating, chances of bloating. Even that bloating is the reason for poor adherence towards metformin. Do you know that? It is so. So irrespective of drugs are given to the patient, but diabetes mellitus will not be controlled because of the poor adherence due to all these problems. And who will be correcting that? The practicing pharmacist will be correcting it. That it is very important to drink at least one tumbler of water after 40 minutes of food. What do some people will do? They will take one bowl of food and one tumbler of one sip of water. So that is a very bad practice. Always to have a food, to have a meal only after 30 or 40 minutes should have water. That is a good healthy habit. So that is very important for the person who is taking metformin. Otherwise, there will be a chance for indigestion. That indigestion will aggravate along with the indigestion, the metformin will aggravate the bloating. That must be one of the cause for a poor patient adherence. This is another problem. And so have a minimum gap of 4 hours if alcohol needs. And after that, adequate amount of water. Then when I talk about adequate amount of water, even people are still confused how much of water should be taken. Could somebody answer how much of water should be taken per day? Okay. People say 4 liter, 5 liter, and so on and so. A person should take water as per his body weight. Just understand, as per his body weight. See, for example, if there is a 70 kg body weight person. So body weight divided by a factor 30. So is equal to the amount of water required per day. So 70, if it is 80, if it is 90, whatever the figure comes. So 70 divided by 30, how much it will come? Approximately 2.3 liters. So 2.3 liters of water is sufficient for a person, mostly sufficient for a person who is moderately active. That is very important. There is another if you have a question like, sir, what will happen if a person is taking 4 liter, 5 liter of water? Water intoxication will happen. Anyway, it will take more time. Water intoxication will take. If it is less water dehydration will take place. And additionally, every half an hour of physical activity, intense physical activity required around 300 ml of additional water. For example, if you go to gym and work out for 1 hour intensively, 600 ml of additional water you require. So if you go to gym, you take 600 ml of water, you fix your time for 1 hour intensive training, complete that additional 600 ml of water that requires your adequate amount of water per day. Then advise crunches. Crunches also like a sort of physical exercise. So which will reduce abdominal bloating as well as body fat will reduce. Then atorvastatin point, I told you like a kidney function test and LFT should be, and preferably, it is always better to take all statins after 2 p.m. Preferably 1 hour postprandial. So why it is so? Because, you know, we studied chronopharmacology, apply that elsewhere, if it is possible. Because cholesterol synthesis in the human body peak after 2 p.m. 2 to 4 p.m. is the time for cholesterol synthesis. So if you take the onset of action of atorvastatin comes mostly around 40 minutes to 1 hour. So if you take 130 or 2, it's more than sufficient, or it is preferably sufficient to reduce your cholesterol synthesis in the liver. So this is why. Then add him some components of fitness, aerobic and muscular endurance, flexibility, all these aspects, this training aspect should be. Because when you practice, you will learn all these things and you have to inform them and educate them and give a balance. Because, you know, you should have a very good attractive chart in your pharmacy clinic where each food, what is the calorie? For example, dosha, 130 calorie, one egg, 97 calorie, one bread piece, 40 calorie, one tea, 80 calorie. So like all this, see, normally average Indian meal comes around 1000 calorie. So three thousand calorie we consume. So you know, maximum per day we require, an inactive person require only 1700 kilocalorie, and a moderately active person needs 2000 calorie, and highly active person requires 3000 calorie. So highly active, in sense, 1 hour of intense training in the gym is highly active. Moderately active means 40 minutes of jogging. Inactive means simply walking somewhere in the verandas and the kitchen. That is not considered as an exercise. Even our parents or mothers, moms used to claim, "No, I am doing kitchen work 3 times in the 4 hours, 5 hours in the kitchen, and it is more than sufficient." No, it is not at all exercise. What is exercise then? Exercise is also defined. Physical activity is defined. So we are having 1440 minutes per day. So can't you schedule 30 minutes out for physical activity for your better living and your safety? This is the question you have to ask the patient. So anyway, just I have added some other points, like, interestingly for you, measuring physical activity intensity. How? So there is a maximum heart rate. This is what we call maximum attainable heart rate. What is that? 220. So 220 minus age. You know, 220, my 39 years, so it comes around, now I am 40, just I prepared last 1 year back, that's what it is. 220 minus 40, say 180. So when I do a physical activity, my heart rate or pulse rate should reach 180 per minute, BPM. It is a physical activity, good physical activity. You know, most of the jogging and all, you can reach only maximum 120, that's all, for 130. You see, the college students, whoever is listening this talk, maybe 20 years. So your heart rate should go to 200. Will it reach? You don't test it today. Don't try to make it today itself. You train slowly for 1 month. And after 1 month of regular training, if you are able to reach this rule, this heart rate, physically you will be fit forever. But you have to follow that. Not for 1 month and then leaving that. Okay. Then having a warm-up zone, training zone, and the fat burning zone, and all this should be educated. Then each exercise is having a dose. See, simply if you say some patient, okay, you do exercise, is it good for diabetes? What exercise? How far it is? And how long it is? So that is very important. So how far? Every day you have to do exercise. If you eat a day, you have to do exercise. And what is the dose? 20 minutes with the 60 to 70% of maximum attainable heart rate. Or, just you understand, or 1 hour with the 30% of maximum attainable heart rate is equal to 1 unit of exercise. What it means? If you jog moderately for 20 minutes, it is more than sufficient. It is 1 unit of exercise. If you are walking very fast and vigorous walking, you need to walk 1 hour. You have to waste your 1 hour time to meet 1 unit of exercise. So what is the beauty of this? So this is a very interesting point to understand. So you can reduce 60 milligram percentage of your blood glucose level. Sorry. So in type 2 diabetes mellitus people, as well as in type 1 diabetes mellitus people, patient. So what is the advantage of that? We can spare 15 international units of insulin in case of diabetes mellitus 1, or if the person is insulin dependent diabetes mellitus. This is very beautiful now. These are a lot of information are available. So this and all you have to convey, and then pharma foods and medifoods, it is a separate talk. Actually, anyway, I'm not going to that one. There are some foods which are indicated for diseases. See, for example, if a person comes with the rheumatoid arthritis, first say no to all saturated fatty acids and list out the foods which contains the unsaturated HUFA fatty acids. So that is very important for such a condition. Like each and every disease condition, we have to schedule the foods and give the examples of the foods which is locally available. You should not say to the people, okay, you go to home and take a strawberry every day. These strawberries available in India elsewhere freely. And what is the cost of that? So find an alternate and our country own food with which the person can cure off or modify or get rid of the disease condition. That is very important. And you make your patient comfort, she will come back to you. So how to, you can sell all this. See, this is not a joke and you may feel silly on me when I am saying all this, but some of the special products, some of the special goods and articles when you sell and which can improve their health and which can make more comfort for their living style, including the podiatric care, chapels and all. So, you know, this and all having 40% to 60% margin. So your income also will increase and the comfortness of the patient also will increase and your practice also will broaden and elaborate. No? Sell and give for healthy outcomes. You know, for example, I say, somebody are coming to you regularly for a pharmacy clinic, to your pharmacy clinic for consultation. Every month on consultation. If he is ready to say, you know, anyway, I'm working in a government side and so I'm not able to allow to do a private practice alongside it. But still, I do a lot of consultation for free of cost. And some people will offer even money and gift, some forms of gift, and if they are getting benefited. But one thing you understand, you have enough knowledge and if you are ready to practice and do not offer this free of cost, then the pharmaceutical service or pharmaceutical care becomes cheaper then. So give them a crucial and valid health information and guidance and make their health better and charge for that. That is very important. Even in holidays and sometimes when I get a consultation, even nowadays through phone, I do that. There is a charging side also. So this and all should be balanced. So when you practice and when people come to you and when there is a very good improvement in his health, you give some pack of 5 or 10 strawberries simply for free of cost or as a gift when at last he is leaving the your clinic premises or before he is getting up from your consultation chair, in front of your consultation chair. So this is what you have to have a business tactics also. And opt to go to natural. Since it is an OTC, you can say, okay, it seems you have some like gingivitis or like some oral problems or some practical common tiredness. Okay, you take saline. Instead of that, you can sell amla in a attracting glasses or glass bowls in your premises, pharmacy. You know, if you have a pharmacy license to sell medicines and you can sell medicines and the food related to curing the disease as well as some of the articles also. It is allowed to sell in a pharmacy. Even yogurt. So these are wonderful things to give to the patient. Yogurt is having excellent advantages in the human healthy system. And anyway, those who are having or interested to know about the yogurt, you can ask me some questions. I will answer during the interaction session. And then fix an appointment and prepare yourself. So you can have an appointment strategy and the on-call appointment, call appointment you can receive and accordingly you can fix your appointment to the patient. Name attractively. This is again not a joke. Just to introduce some of the students, when I was taking this webinar to some other institution, I have given some examples. Pharmacist healthcare, your wellness destination. This is your heading board titled. So consultant name, qualification, consultation time, appointment consultation time, you give a separate timing for that, attractively. Another lifeline, Kottayam. Since I live in Kottayam, simply I have quoted this. Lifestyle and metabolic disease pharmacist. So if the patient comes to this type of patients, who diabetes mellitus, rheumatoid arthritis, and hypercholesterolemia, and any metabolic disease patient. You come to this pharmacist, if this pharmacist will have a medication therapy management as well as counsel the patient and charge. And Emerge, another clinic name, pharmacy clinic. Cancer and the immune care pharmacist. You can have a board like this. And another one, for example, Pharmacia. Your food and medicine mentor. So if you go to this pharmacist, he will advise you wonderful foods, good foods, the excellent foods, which makes you more healthy. In spite of that, you can avoid the drugs and medications slowly. Or those who are healthy also go to this pharmacist, get all these informations and advices, so he will not become a patient in future. So how wonderful it is. So this you have to propagate, such a way you have to practice. So this is another question. When we say one of the surgeon asked me a question, very very normal question. Let me read the question. Sir, if we give 500 ml of 5% dextrose, how much will the blood sugar raise by, and how much dose does 1 unit of rapid acting insulin decrease blood sugar by? So this the question sent to me through WhatsApp, and he was a surgeon. Probably I thought this may be for his patient, and he is working in our hospital. So I given an answer like 500 ml of 5% dextrose contains 25 grams of blood sugar. This is very normal because we are expert in calculations, this type of chemical calculations. Yeah? The number of grams of carb handled by your own unit of insulin should be calculated. That is very important. So for now, he is going to give 25 grams of carbohydrate extra to the patient after surgery or before surgery, whatever it is. So by the below method, the patient already under insulin therapy, calculate the grams of carbohydrate handled by insulin by using one formula. What is the formula? 2.8 into body weight in pound divided by present insulin units. What is the present insulin unit? Already the patient may be taking or under insulin. So how much additional insulin need to be given? That was the question. So this is the answer for that question. So accordingly, see, now this formula and all, even I do not know by heart. But when it comes, I know what are the resources from where I will get this. So immediately I will take a resource and give the answer within a minute. So this is what actually, so this here within a minute, he asked it in 8:44, I replied in 10:55. Only when I saw that time I replied. If it was a hurry, he must have called me through phone. But I think it was not hurry, it seems. So this is what we have to involve and evolve. And the resource at a glance. So this is for a pharmacist population in Kerala I have met. If time permits, I can take another 5 minutes and explain. Am I? The organizers?
Yes, sir. Please go ahead.
Yeah. And the pharmacist in Kerala, as per this prepared before, I think, 4 or 8 months back. Okay, anyway. 48,000 as per 2020. So it means in Kerala population, the entire population of Kerala is 3.6 crores. So WHO ratio, as per WHO ratio, we should have one pharmacist per 1,000 population, but in Kerala we have 1.25 pharmacists per 1,000 population. You see, as I projected on slide earlier, In an Indian community, average of 15% of the community will visit hospital. It is in a rotatory manner, frequent manner, rotatory manner, an average statistics. So 15% of 3.6 crores means 50 lakh hospitals or clinic visits. So these are individual visits, like patient visits. So you calculate if 50% of pharmacists practice in the pharmacy clinic. So what is the 50% pharmacist means? That figure, 48,000 divided by 2, that means 24,000. Half of the pharmacy populations are practicing by opening a clinic, pharmacy clinic. And how much? 225 patients per pharmacist you will get a month. Amazing. You see, this much of resource is available. We have resource and we are running behind something else. You fix 100 rupees. If I practice after my retirement, if I leave, I definitely will practice with the 500 rupees or as per today rate, I say 500 rupees. That time it may be increasing more. That will be my rate per patient. If a poor patient comes, sometime it will be free of cost. That is different. Anyway, if 100 rupees if we fix, so 22,500 rupees per month you can earn out of this. So average of 7.3 patients per day. So this is an average calculation. If we have skill and knowledge incorporation, definitely you can attract a lot of patients. You can have pharmaceutical care service within your clinic. So I say, if you are able to sell some products, some drugs, some cosmetics, some nutraceuticals, nutrients, foods. And always you should not depend upon nutraceuticals. Better to sell the nutrients as such, as a food. So minimum 1 lakh you can gain out of a month. I'm not bogusing. You sit and think. So what are you going to say public after listening to me? This is very important. We have the mission to save every Indian's life by changing the Indian healthcare delivery system. That is very important. Just understand, we are going to change. We have a mission to change the Indian healthcare delivery system. From being product-centric to patient-centric. So this reason I have told you so many things. Anyway, I don't want to hurt some physician community. But if there is a question during question answer session, definitely I will involve to have a healthy discussions upon this. But now in India, the healthcare delivery system is product centric, certainly. Majority of the system is situation, in majority of the situation, it is product centric. But we have to make it to patient centric. So how to achieve this? So for this, we promote pharmaceutical care everywhere. So what is pharmaceutical care? That's what I was explaining all this. By this 1.5 hour, I was explaining about pharmaceutical care. So this is end of my presentation explanation. And I am not a presently practicing pharmacist, full-fledged practicing pharmacist, but I can. I am doing partly. Basically, I am a pharmacologist and doing research associated as well as academic activities. So majorly, I am appointed as a teacher here. So, you know, all college teachers or university teachers should incorporate teaching as well as research. So research is one of my passion. So we do research and this is one of our publication. So I'm the major focus of most of the publications are like sirtuins. This is another one. Yes. So now, it is open for the audience to have questions and it is one of my requests to have lots of arguments and questions for another even 15 minutes or half an hour. I will be here to solve your questions and queries in the possible way. If I do not know, we will definitely refer and I will let you know later. So I anticipate and solicit active participation from the participants to have questions.
Yeah. Thank you so much, sir. That was a very informative session. And there are a few questions where a student have asked in the chat box. I will read out to you. So one of the student has asked that, Kavya Vishwanath, she's asked, on the last day, I happened to hear even interns of our hospital suffer.
Read slowly.
Oh, sorry. Yeah. On the last day, I happened to hear even interns of our hospital suffer a lot of discrimination and insult from senior physicians assigned to them in the hospital. As a PharmD student myself, it is disheartening to know that. What can we do about it? How can we improve ourselves? And she thanks you for giving such wonderful insight, like opening our clinic and all of that. So.
Yeah, fine. Okay, anyway, I will answer for this. But after this, you shall allow the participants to ask questions so that they will have, we will have some vocal coordination also.
It's open now.
You can unmute. You can unmute them and allow them. That will be better. Yes. Anyway, see, as I told you, I am not going to give 100% right answer for this. But majorly, it is an ego. See, now it is very clear that discrimination and insult from senior physicians. If somebody insulting you, he is out of ego or out of jealous, out of fear. So out of ego, out of jealous, out of fear, or overcoming some of the positions of today's physician community in future. If disease allowed, if disease getting stronger, you know, physicians are so busy, they are not able to, even they are not having time to answer the questions, or even sometimes, you know, physicians say, why are you asking these silly questions? This will be a statement towards a patient's question. It is absolutely wrong. So why, what is the claim of the today's Indian physician community? We are so busy, hundreds of people are waiting outside, and I cannot answer all this stupid things to you, all these questions answer to you. Yes, boss, you are busy. That's what we say, we are here. You do diagnosis and prescribe. Remaining everything, you will medication, therapy, management, we will do. For that, we are here. So who should ask this? Public should ask. If you go to public and say, this is what the system. So tomorrow onwards, you ask the physician or government to have or incorporate the clinical pharmacist or practicing pharmacist service. And sometime it will be a manipulated dialogue. But the community should feel. So there should be a high pressure towards the enforcement department of our country through government and organizations, and our regulatory authorities and regulatory bodies, from Pharmacy Council of India to CDSCO, Pharmacovigilance Program, and IPC, India Pharmacopeial Commission. So the ministerial level and administrative level, proper awareness and information of knowledges, and as well as there should be a public pressure from the layman to implement or force this in a healthcare system. Until or otherwise, you will receive this type of insult and discrimination. And you take it positively. You laugh inside you that, yes, you have a fear of our profession growing, our professional growth. That's what you are doing. All this, you don't mind. You're trying to tackle now. And once you acquire your degree and you come out of that system, you have it. See, this is what we are, a professional graduates. You know? What does it mean, professional? You can practice. An engineer can practice. Electrical engineer can practice himself. Like as a plumber or, you know, as a electrician. And so anybody, any professional people can practice. But those who are having a qualified, well-acquired degree, and internationally acquired degree, and holding, you are living inside India, you have all legal permittability, then why can't you practice and think of practice? So this is what you have to overcome from this native situation, I would like to say. Anyway, other audience can please ask the questions directly.
Thank you, sir. There is another question from Anusha Srinarayan. I would request Anusha Srinarayan to unmute and ask the question directly to sir.
Good afternoon, sir.
Good afternoon.
My question is there any particular class of drug which causes so much of ADR and mortality?
Yeah, political.
Sorry, sir. Is there any particular class of drug which causes so much of ADR and mortality? You mentioned, right? There is a lot of death because of ADR.
ADR, fine. Okay. No, actually, the reason actually, when the intravenous drugs are administered, even antibiotics to immunosuppressants and some like plasma expanders or some antipyretics. So these type of IV administration especially will have a hazardous effect. And antibiotics and anti-diabetic drugs will have a hazardous effect.
Okay.
For example, if cephaloxin normally given to a person who is having a deep wounds, and even for pre-surgical as well as post-surgical, cephaloxin will be given. Some people, cefuroxime one or two dose will lead to kidney dysfunction, and you know, after 8 hours even, the creatinine level goes to 3-4. And if the physician is not looking at that, and the fourth day, fifth day, how much degree of kidney damage the patient will be around. And even it leads to sometime after discharge, after 1 year or 2 year or 3 year back, the patient come back to the hospital as a kidney failed patient, isn't it?
Yes, sir.
Yeah, so this is what. So, you know, on another example, I will tell you, which happened in a government hospital. Unfortunately, I'm not mentioning the hospital and as well as the physician, an orthopedic surgeon. And fellow of around below 25 years of age.
Oh.
Some fertilizer. He was working in a fertilizer company, a representative. And he came to, he admitted in the hospital, brought to casualty with one leg almost amputated due to accident. But unfortunately, most of the situation, the patient will be unconscious after this type of severe damage or accident. But unfortunately, he was not.
Mm-hmm.
What happened? He was shouting and crying very loud. And all of a sudden, the PG doctor, the postgraduate student of orthopedic surgery, he given IV diazepam. You know, after 2 minutes, he expired.
Okay.
So the IV diazepam probably must cause anaphylactic reaction. You know, the postmortem. I know a lot of examples I have. Anyway, since I am working in a governmental setup, so we have a lot of forensic surgeons. They are very, very genuine to the public. They used to share some information professionally. Not even Kapsarp killed a 32-year man last year, 2 years back. Even I have all the data. Got it?
Yes, sir.
Okay. So, an antibiotic, a bad combination of antibiotic and the Kapsarp, macrolide and the Kapsarp will produce dosaridine pointers, ectopic pacemaker activity. That may be sufficient to kill some patient during sleep. Got it?
Sir, I have another question.
Yeah.
PharmD students are already a part of clinical practice and hospital pharmacy, right?
Okay.
So, yes. Will there be an opportunity for the M.Pharm graduates also to be a part of it? And if so, how should we cope up?
No, this, I think your question regard to recent amendment, right? Isn't it?
Sorry, sir. Can you please be a little louder?
No, your question is regarding the recent amendment, the issue regarding the recent amendment of pharmacy practice regulation,
huh.
Right?
Huh.
Yeah. So this is what actually, see, when the point of, I don't know, see, I didn't have any personal discussion with the Pharmacy Council of India president, but I at most respected Dr. D. Suresh. I know personally, I was working under him for 5 years. And so he's the objective of Pharmacy Council of India to nurture the need of PharmD students within the country. So now in the clinical setup, they made PharmD mandatory. But see, there are a lot of industrial setup and pharmacovigilance setup and the pharmacy clinic and even in the dispensaries and even your own consultation, the pharmacy practice graduate can work even in research side, isn't it? Right? Okay, so then there is a stream gradually. See, when a new system is involving or introducing in India or any country, sometimes there may be a need of drastic changes. So you consider this as a drastic transition from one side to another side, where the PharmD graduates are going to get a very specific title in so-called hospital or clinical pharmacist. But another, all other opportunities are open to everybody from B-Pharm. You know, a D-Pharm diploma holder can also open a pharmacy clinic and can do all the job, whatever I was explaining, isn't it?
Yes.
This is what, So now the bigger challenge is actually competing with the allopathic, in the allopathic system. Now the pharmacist community, the biggest professional challenge is competing with the medicine. And we have to enact the NCA strict rules, the generic prescription, capital letter writing. And you know, I have asked our government of Kerala in the last ministry 2 years back. I have wrote a letter to health minister stating that representative meeting a doctor and introducing some of the gifts and articles, even some favors to write medication directly or indirectly. So that will lead to polypharmacy, and these should be considered as a illegal and hazardous to the community patient. So consider this act as a illegal. If I'm saying all this, your representative friends and somebody planning to go as a representative after this, so you will be angry to me. But that should be considered as a illegal. Why illegal? Because this representative and physician direct meeting always leads to brokerage. There is a high chance for brokerage. It is happening. So that should be stopped. then how the pharmaceutical companies can sell the products. Yes, pharmaceutical companies can sell the products to only the retailers or wholesalers. That channel is already available in India. So that is only way to sell the products, isn't it? So advertisements. So except OTC products, advertisements are not possible. So all this comes under Schedule J. And Schedule X should not be advertised. There is a well-defined rule. Then why? What is the need of a personal advertisement through a representative? That is also part of advertisement. That should be considered as illegal. So who should implement that one? Drugs and Cosmetics Act from CDC, SEO itself, there should be an amendment and this should be well written and make as a gazette notification. If it comes as a gazette notification, then all the states can implement that same system.
Okay, sir.
So what happens then? The patient is, this is what.
Thank you, Anusha. So there's one more student, Vikas Manu, who wants to ask the question. Vikas, could you please unmute yourself and ask the question?
Greetings, sir. Hello. Am I audible, sir?
Tell me, please.
My question is regarding general, sir, like the mindset of people. Most of the like graduates, what we can see in our villages, sir, like somebody does MBBS, they'll get their bachelor's degree in it and they'll open a clinic in the village kind of thing, sir. So if we start as a pharmacist to open a pharmacy clinic, so won't there be a judgment, sir, by the public, like only our doctors are have a right to open clinics, why this pharmacy fellow is coming and indulging into our like business kind of thing? So how we have to educate them is regarding my question, sir.
You need not to educate, you have to spread some, or we have to spread and propagate some message. Actually, you know, the concept of pharmacy in the layman, in the Indian community, when somebody called, say, pharmacy, means immediately they will picturize some shop where medicines are selling, isn't it? Okay, it is a drugstore actually, and we can say even defined like pharmacy, but pharmacy or pharmacist consultation is something which improves your health by looking at the pitfalls or drawbacks of the medicines or drugs and what you eat and what you do. So your lifestyle and your food and as well as your drug already prescribed, we will have a check over it. And if there is a problem, we are going to correct it. For that, you give me a fee. This is a system which is available abroad. And this is what the abroad people or developed country people are getting benefited from last so many decades. But it is not happening in India. Such a way, you cannot talk to each and everyone. See, for example, if somebody is planning to start a pharmacy consultation within their small town, and they can have a Rotary Club meeting, and they can attend their Lions Club meeting, and give a presentation to such clubs, and you can have a public meeting in a panchayat hall or some city hall. So initially, 4 or 5 people or your smaller association of private pharmacist practice association, if you register a society, well, you can register. And 100 or 200 people together, if you join, so you can meet the expenses by sharing. And these type of programs can be conducted and you can make it legal. And all legal points, you focus to the authority. And in such a way, you can slowly make the public to educate and know about the pharmacy practice clinic and how they can be getting benefited. Then very simple, we sit and meanwhile, see, when I explaining this, you may think that yes, this we have to do for 6 months or 1 year, then we have to start a clinic. It is not so. Simultaneously, with the low investment, very low quality budget, low amount of budget, moderately you start a clinic and start practicing over them. Then if you are doing good, this message will propagate among that particular community. Definitely the people or patient will come. The person who is coming to you need not to be a patient. A gentleman or gentlewoman come to you. You can modify, you can make them better health. You know, a person who is living at 45, they're having no disease, definitely will have a curiosity and wish of not getting disease by 50, 55, isn't it? So you ask them to come to your clinic. clinic and you ask what is their food, you know, very simple example I will tell you for this question. And what is the quantity of salt intake, or what should be the quantity of salt intake for day, per day, do you know? It is 6 grams oil, 6 grams. So a person who is consuming more than 6 grams of sodium chloride definitely will become hypertensive, most probably after late 50s or late 40s, isn't it? So how many people do know that? And as I told you, how much water to drink, that is also people are not knowing about it. No? So if a person comes to you saying, I am near to hypertensive, but not at started drugs, so what should I do? You ask how many members at home, they say 4. For example, I say, they say 4. Okay, how many packets of salt you are purchasing every month? Then they will think, okay, you call to your wife and ask how many months. So she say, we purchase only 1 packet. And will 1 packet completely uses? Yes, yes, completely uses. Sometime additional quarter packets also will be utilized. So that means was 1 kilo, 250 grams of salt is using per month. So as I said to you, 24 grams of salt should be consumed for a 4 persons family, individual family, isn't it? So for month it is 24 into 30, so it comes around 750. So 500 grams of sodium chloride every month the particular family is consuming more, definitely they will become hypertensive, isn't it? So schedule accordingly. Got it? Okay, then there are a lot of things, oil, food, and a lot of foods also. Some foods, repeated eating of some foods will have some morbidity. So lot of informations are there anyway. It is a very restricted time, we cannot tell you all examples. So to ignite you, I just quoted an example, such a way we can broaden and elaborate and make our profession clear, isn't it?
Yes sir, thank you.
Yeah,
thank you Vikas. So there's one more question from Pratiksha. Pratiksha, please unmute yourself and you can ask the question.
Meanwhile, when they are asking question, you can focus that, scroll down that question also. So if the voice is not clear, I can even simultaneously, I can read and understand the question. Yeah. If it is there, if written questions are there, otherwise no problem. Let them ask. Yeah.
They have not written the question. They'll be asked.
Fine. Then let them ask. Yeah. Yeah. Please.
Pratiksha, please unmute your mic and ask the question.
Good afternoon, sir.
Good afternoon.
My question is, sir, in previous slides you have mentioned that the job satisfaction in this profession is currently 50% in the level. So how do you suggest, how would you suggest that it could be increased, in what ways, sir?
Increase in?
Like the satisfaction level could be increased than 50%, which is currently there, sir.
Yeah. So what is your question?
How could we increase it?
See, if I need good satisfaction over my profession, what I need? I need a comfort atmosphere to work, an easy atmosphere to work, hassle-free, good salary, isn't it? So these are the three major requirements for a job satisfaction. So I am ready to work for 8 hours. Because there is a general principle, 8 hour work, 8 hour sleep, 8 hour recreation. So if somebody is having this balanced schedules of working, 8 into 8 plus 8 plus 8, and a good salary, see, good salary in sense, that's what I told you, as per the inflation rate, all central and state government employees are drawing 4 to 7% of DA hike every year. But why it is only to government? Why it is not in the private side? Because when the private situation comes, there is a high level of profit motive, and the majority of the share of the business will go to the saving, and the very less will be towards the expenditure, so less salary. But why physicians? Because they are the crucial role takers of an allopathic system. Without them, the show cannot be run. So that is what. But you know, that also now changes. In Kerala, the MBBS fellow or some of the MBBS fellows are getting only 15,000 to 25,000 rupees salary. Even that too, they have to work in, they have to take night duties in the casualty, and the maximum they are getting 40,000-45,000 only. Got it? Okay. So all the promotion, there is a dilution. But this dilution, how can we evolve better in this, even the dilution scenario, and how to make our job better. So we have to first equip with the skill as well as knowledge. See, if you are a good skilled and knowledgeable person and working for 15 or 20,000 rupees salary, definitely after 1 year of job or 6 months of job, in future you will get somewhere good job, isn't it? So the professional adequacy, we have to meet. As per the professional adequacy, the scenario gradually will change. So first, the education system, the quality of the teachers, quality of the students also should be increased. That is also very, very important. Once a person enrolled to pharmacy, and how he is getting passed, and how he is acquiring the degree. And once the person enrolled to MBBS, how he is getting passed, and how he is enrolled to degree. So this drastically differs now. Anyway, I don't want to pinpoint the private institution part, even in government side also. So these dilutions gradually need to be changed. Anyway, this will take longer time. What I suggest is, like, if you are courageous, if you are having an incorporation of knowledge and skill, you can think of and implementing a practice clinics.
Okay, sir. Thank you, sir.
Okay, welcome.
Thank you, Pratiksha. Next question is from Shanak.
Yeah, please.
Yes, ma'am. Sir, I'm audible.
Yeah, sure, please.
Sir, this is with regarding, like, before you were saying the setting up of clinics and consulting and all of that. Sir, I think recently the National Medical Commission also had few suggestions, like allied healthcare and pharmacists can work in primary healthcare centers and, you know, assist. So my question was, like, even if there is awareness in laypersons that, you know, this is also a job of pharmacists.
No, my question is, up to that it was clear. My question is that after that, only just repeat, please repeat the question.
Yes, sir. So my question was, even if we convince laypersons that pharmacists...
Layperson. Layman, okay. Yeah.
If we, that, you know, this is also a part of pharmacist job, how do we convince the physician community, like after the NMC recommendations
came in? We need not to convince the physician. Let them do their job. We know
sir,
what is our job.
I just wanted to add one thing. Like after the NMC recommendations came in, the Indian Medical Association and almost every doctor community in the country, they called all this as quackery, and, you know, they termed it as compounding. So if the, like, main members of the healthcare sector are against it, how do we initiate this change?
Okay, fine. Is your question over? Can I say answer?
Yeah. Yes, sir.
Yeah, it is not 100% answer. All the answer, whatever I am giving, is as per best of my knowledge only, limited to my knowledge. I'm sorry for that. And, you know, in China, they have a TCM, traditional and complementary medicine. In Chinese system as well as in Japan system, including this tolerant people, what is that? So alcohol tolerant community, what is that country? I forgot now. I know. Okay, anyway. Koreans. So Koreans, Chinese, and as well as in Japan, they have a very good system of incorporation of allopathy and the traditional medicine. So, see, you know, in how China and Japan is tackling COVID. So mainly in China, they have a very good tool of using traditional and complementary medicine, such a way their medical council is permitted their educational as well as the practice regulations. In China, those who study modern medicine should study, alongside they should study traditional complementary medicine also. Wherever applicable, accordingly, they have to treat with either allopathy or traditional and complementary medicine. Unfortunately, which is not present in the Indian system. We strictly adhere to allopathy system in allopathic system. In Ayurveda, we have only Ayurvedic system. So what is the problem? The modern technology is not incorporated to Ayurveda. So see, Ayurveda is having a beautiful remedy for various ailments which cannot be cured or treated by allopathy. Definitely, lot of examples even we could say. So such incorporation is very, very poor in this. Now, we had a diesel car and we had a petrol car. Now we have an electric car. But in all these cars, how much it evolved to a beautiful level where the comfort is so high and the cost also very high, right? If you have a Audi or if you have a Benz, and the cost is very high, accordingly the comfort and safety is very high, right? So such a way the allopathy system have not evolved. So there's an unfortunate thing in India. So it will take a lot of time to happen that one. But the National Medical Council, though they stated this and all, they are suggestions. And it is not a legally validated and legally enforced. Okay. So with our legal validity, by convincing our, that means the pharmacy council and the concerned ministry of family and the health and family welfare department. So we have to try to utilize our opportunity to broaden the practice perspective. So for that, actually, even some, as I told you, the medi foods or pharma foods, what is that one? Somebody called this an Ayurveda. Now people, when I had a talk in on Lions Club meeting, like on live session before COVID, the topic was like medi food or pharma food. At last, some people asked, sir, have you changed it from pharmacology to Ayurveda? It looks like you are so much expertise in Ayurveda. It's not, it's life science. It is a, like we have a, so again, we have an attitude like if I am pharmacology, I should learn only pharmacology, I should speak only pharmacology. No, if I am pharmacy, I speak biological science. I will coordinate the beauty of medicinal chemistry and biology, isn't it? So like we have to broaden. See, the translation, that's what I given the title itself, translational pharmacy. So from the conventional pharmacy to bedside pharmacy or patient-oriented pharmacy, that's it's a bit easy. So our approach should change accordingly. Got it? Could you hear me?
Yes, sir. Got it. Yeah. Thanks a lot.
Yeah.
Thank you, sir. So there's one more question from Rishabh Nath. Rishabh, please unmute your mic and ask the question. Yes, Prashant. Please unmute your mic and you can ask.
Hello, good afternoon, sir.
Yeah, please, little loudly.
Sir, I have one question, sir.
Yeah, please.
Sir, how this e-pharmacy is successful in India, sir?
Yeah, e-pharmacies contribute, as far as my knowledge, it contributes only 3 to 5% of sales volume at present. But now the focus of Indian Chamber of Commerce, now they have affiliated to that chamber, and Ministry of Health and Family Welfare Department now asked the Ministry of, the Indian Chamber of Commerce to review the terms and conditions and the law regulatory aspects of e-pharmacy sale in India. It happened in 2019, but it has not even came a draft regulation now. So yet to come. So we hope OTC preparations and some of the drug formulations sale is going to boom through e-pharmacy. Definitely, we cannot prevent that one. Let it happen. That's what I say. Accordingly, we have to change and evolve our attitude towards practice side, isn't it?
Okay.
Thank you, Rishabh. So there's one more question. Vikas have to ask something else. So Vikas.
Last question, sir. It's not regarding a completely aspect of pharmacy, but general the mindset, sir. As we pass on, like a stages will come, right? So as from a student point of view, like he passes 10th.
Request actually, when you ask a question, just introduce me. Where are you studying? Okay, where are you studying? Actually, in Ramaya or some other institute?
Yeah, sir. I'm currently pursuing my B-Pharm in Ramaya.
B-Pharm, very good. Yeah, then,
Sir. It was regarding that only. Like, if you choose science field, right, sir, like we'll pass the 12th, like pursuing physics, chemistry, and background, physics, chemistry, and mathematics, as well as any 4 combinations, sir. Okay. So what will be taught? Like, you'll pursue BSc basic in science. You'll go to engineering. You'll go to medical field, paramedics and all, but no one as per as my knowledge in my current environment, they haven't gave knowledge me about B-Pharm, sir. It was through my research that I got this. So what we can make, sir, to build up the knowledge of pharmacy line throughout the country?
Yeah, I captured your question.
Sorry, sir, couldn't able to hear you.
Same one. Do you have any other questions? Could you hear me?
Sir, we lost you in between.
Am I connected?
I'm sorry, sir, we lost you
in between. Could you? Okay. Could you hear me now?
Yeah, we can hear you now, sir.
Yeah, fine. I think the data is getting finishing. Yeah, fine. Okay. So, who was asking the question? Vigas, right?
Yes, sir.
Vigas? Did you finish your question or do you have some more?
No, sir. I finished my question.
Yeah. See, the thing is like when you have a problem, like you are, anyway, in the life, on our lifeline, we are exposed to a lot of services, correct? Now, so we are exposed to bus service, we are exposed to lorry service, we are exposed to electric service, electricians and plumbers and physician and engineers and a lot of arts and science college schools and arts and science colleges everywhere in most of the urban and village sites, right? Okay, when British and after independence we started expanding your educational system of our India, the government of India as well as all the states started having or constructing arts and science colleges. So, BSc and science and arts and science, all subjects, it is very famous throughout our country. But what about pharmacy actually? See, in Banaras Hindu University in 1920s, when the B.Pharm graduates started first time, but accordingly, the societal development of pharmacy did not happen in India. So only it stopped or it came up to the pharmacy shops or so-called drug stores. So the practice perspective, we have not reached. So that is the major drawback according to your question. So the profession is not in fame because public or the people are not aware of it. So this is another, that's not a big challenge only. So, you have to read the history of US pharmacy. So when you, Proctor, when you look at the pharmacy, the father of pharmacy from Proctor, and then you can see the evolution of pharmacy happened from 1870s onwards. But in India, it happened only from 1970s onwards. So we are 100 years back when comparing US. So hopefully what we are speaking will effectively will happen in India in another 100 years. But we cannot enjoy that, fruitful effect of that system. But so this is what the challenge now, what we have to do. We have to fasten the development by incorporating indoor sectoral as well as the skill and the knowledge side of pharmacy profession. So this is a big challenge. Each and every one who is listening this talk, or you have to spread this message to others, and so it is a big task only. But I am not negatively focusing. Until or otherwise, we evolve to practice in the clinics, the pharmacy practice. Otherwise, it is not going to gain a fame, and so the public, then again, it will be obsolete from the society. Okay.
Yes, sir. Thank you.
Yeah.
Thank you, sir. Those were the questions that we had. Now I would request Mrs. Gauri Nair to propose the vote of thanks.
Good afternoon, everyone. It is my honor and privilege to conclude this session by extending a word of thanks. First of all, we are very much thankful to the management, Honorable Vice Chancellor, Pro Vice Chancellor, M.S. Ramaiah University of Applied Sciences, for their continuous encouragement and support in conducting webinars. On behalf of all the faculty members of Department of Pharmacology, I thank our Dean for his valuable guidance all through the conduction of this webinar. And we are really fortunate to have an eminent speaker today, today's webinar, Dr. Shani Shantini. In spite of his busy schedule, he agreed to deliver this talk, and we are very much thankful to you, sir.
Thank you.
I express the gratitude to Mrs. Satya also, Assistant Professor, for delivering the welcoming remarks. And I would also like to thank Ms. Hajra Banu, Mr. Damodar Nayak, Assistant Professor, for coordinating the smooth conduction of this webinar. I would also like to convey my sincere appreciation to Dr. J. Anpu and Dr. Mohammed Azmatullah, Department of Pharmacology, for their support and cooperation throughout the process to successfully conduct this webinar. On my personal behalf and on behalf of Department of Pharmacology, Faculty of Pharmacy, I profusely thank all the participants for their active participation, support, and presence in making this program a noteworthy success. Thank you. Thank you on and on.